everybody, alliance builders out there. Do you have your alliance building hats on? Your alliance building shoes and arms? I want to welcome everybody who's not only just here, but watching us online. In the spirit of combating secrecy, surveillance, and censorship, everything you say will be recorded and live streamed. So bear that in mind. I'm here to introduce a man who has been the bad news bear of, I think, half a dozen or more administrations in Washington, D.C. Every time a president sends out his spokesperson to say the sky is blue, there's a sigh to say it's not only not blue, it's falling. He is a secret sharer. He's also a secret keeper. He is famous, and he's the sort of hero of hackers everywhere for his ability to keep the secrecy of his sources. He's broken stories from My Lai to Abu Ghraib, but he's more inclined than not to say they're not his stories, to say they're the stories of people, men and women, he calls not whistleblowers, but members of the administration, the successive administration officials who care deeply about actually doing the job they've committed to do and to serving the public. With that, we'll go straight to it. Sai, thank you so much for coming. We're so glad to have you. Sai will give us a little bit of a keynote, and then we'll talk for a little bit.
I don't have much to say except to say that, you know, it's... My view is very simple, that the world basically, since I've been old enough to read, is basically run by nincompoops, idiots, thieves, crooks. I mean, probably, and I think the only salvation are, unfortunately, the idiots who run most of the mainstream media. But that's true. The fact is that's our job. I mean, we're in a funny position. Whether we're in mainstream or whether we're online or whether we're brand new, whether we're running a blog, it's changing so much so quickly. It's a little inchoate. It's far from perfect, but it's a very hopeful process. What's going on now? We're getting off the notion that you have to live and die on the basis of the national magazines and the national newspapers. And so, as I say, it's unformed. It will get better, and that's it. That's all we have. The only purpose I see of I think what all of us here, whether you're in journalism or in trying to protect information, the whole purpose of what I think we should be doing is counter narrative. That's all. It's just the word counter narrative. They have their narrative, and we have to show there's another narrative. I could go on forever and tell you about things going on today in the Middle East and the wars and stuff like that, in which you're not getting everything there is to know. We have an American president that unfortunately has chosen to join the ranks of those who don't tell the truth. In fact, this is an administration in Washington that's probably as bad as any other in terms of the high-level people not being straight with each other. It's sort of an amazing situation. You'd think we'd get better at it, but we're not. And so I would just say that this is easy here. I can go and tell you how important it is to do journalism. I'm going, I was telling Laura, I'm going tomorrow to Amman, where I'm going to be with, there's 400 aspiring wannabe investigative journalists from 9 countries in the Middle East, including Palestine, who are gathering in Amman, a strange place because the king, like all the Sunni leaders, is cracking down. They're in total fear of what's coming. There's a sea change coming, which you probably aren't being told enough. It's going to be a Shia world. It's coming, and probably it's okay, because it just might be better. Who knows? In any case, I'm going to tell them the same thing I'm telling you, which is, you go out and you get the counter narrative. The only difference is they're going to go out and get their heads bashed. In America, I do this stuff and I get patted on the head and get prizes. And so it's a different situation there, but it's the same process. Even if you can't publish, I'm sure I'm going to say this Sunday when I speak, even the act, even if you can't get it in print, the act of asking, the act of doing, the act of putting it down, it's all about, it sounds so corny to say this, it's all about an informed society. And you're not going to be informed by the leadership. And we all know how pathetic they are, and they have been for so many years. So that's our function, and that's what's, so anything you can do to make it easier. I frankly, I'm not as worried, I'll let Laura ask me questions.
All right. I'm not as worried. I want to go to the end of that sentence, but we'll get there before the end. What makes a great Cy Hersh story? What do you look for?
Yesterday, the papers were full of a story that said Iran did some flying submissions. They flew some strikes. I don't know if you follow the news. Iran, the Iranian Air Force, F-4s were flying, and they did a strike in Iraq. And the only reason we know about it is Al Jazeera had photographs of the planes, and they initially were reported as probably being Iraqi Air Force planes, but the Iraqi Air Force doesn't have F-4s. The only country that does is Iran. And so the newspapers, I think I always tear stuff out in airplanes. The New York Times had the yesterday's paper. I think I have it here. If not, I could probably replicate it. I think I tore this clip out. I stand on like a little old lady in the airplane tearing up planes. The guy next to me, you know, it's a good thing. But anyway, the point is, to get to the question.
Strange
is,
substance you have there.
No, I'm doing something. So that's something. What's going on? And the New York Times had a story saying, well, what's going on? We're all pretending, you know, are they working together? And so we had it the other day in Raqqa, which some of you may know is the headquarters for ISIS, which is the current new great threat, and it is. Sunni fanatics have one thing that's a lot different than secular fanatics. Sunni fanatics really believe others who don't accept their version, their religious version, should be done away with. They're exposable. They're disposable. It's not just a question of coercing others, as secular fanatics would do. They would terrify to coerce others to be acquiescent. In Sunni nutty land, you kill them. You kill those who you don't. They're not worth living. You stop buses and you shoot those who can cite the right phrases from the Quran. You've read about that. So it is a threat. So what's going on? We had a bombing in Raqqa the other day, and first American planes bombed Raqqa. Raqqa's the capital of ISIS, so we think. And followed then by a bombing by the Syrian Air Force. And the State Department announced, my God, what's going on? The Syrians went and they killed a lot of people. Here's the reality. We, the Americans, have been working, obviously, with the Iranians and the Syrians. Air Forces don't fly in competition with each other. That's just not what they do. We're working together. Clearly, we have been helping Syria with tactical intelligence for a long time, probably through the Germans, in fact, through the Germans. Clearly, that there's a decision has been made by the intelligence community in America probably 2.5 years ago that the only people that can win, whether you like him or don't like him, is Bashar Assad, because he is from the Ba'ath Party. He is secular, as was Saddam Hussein. And so I just think this is a rich story. I'm not going to do it because I'm doing other things, but it's a rich story. There's clearly a lot there we're not being told.
So how would you go about it? Everybody wants to know, how do you find your sources?
I sneak. I don't file a freedom of information. I sneak. I talk to people who know things. Period. How else do I do it?
And your favorite question.
I can invent it.
Your favorite question, of course, is always, who are your sources?
Yeah. Sure, if you think that's my favorite question, you're in some fantasy land. I've been asked that by judges, so this, you know, it's no. For the hackers here, one story I will tell you. 10, 11, 12 years ago, early in the Bush-Cheney days, and by the way, it's much easier to write a story about Bush and Cheney than it is about Obama, but that's the way it is. I was dealing with somebody who really knows what's going on. And we started becoming friends. It's just a question of trust. No, it's not. It's more than that. It's, if you live in the secret world, it's in America, just as it is here in the GCHQ, it's all compartment. And you know, we do still measure manhood by how many, in the old days it used to be how many badges you have. Now it's all hologram. You know, you have a card that you put in a computer, and it's got different levels of security. But that's a measure of manhood. And so, if somebody inside could tell me something and I don't run the printed, if I keep on working it and I find something else inside, that's a source of comfort for him, because when the government does a damage assessment, I'm getting sort of technical here, when they do a damage assessment of something secret, they first see what special programs, what special clearances you have. And if you have a story that has some special stuff in it that your guy didn't have, he's home free. So the guys on the inside know that they can deal with me because I'm not going to write till I get something else from a special access program. They call it a SAP. That's the highest category in America. I get something else from inside. I know that sounds like complicated inside baseball, but there is a certain, so there's certain safety in dealing with me.
Sounds like kind of traditional journalism.
Well, the same thing. It's sort of just working it so you don't nail one guy. But one of these guys one day, this is early in the Cheney administration, we became friendly. We started talking. It happened because of something, and I got his phone. Anyway, I started seeing him. And after two or three times, I was taking notes like I do. I have these long pads. I don't use electronic devices. And after the second time, I said, look, this is getting complicated because I'm getting a lot of information for you, and I want to organize it better, so I'm going to get another computer and not go online. And my friend said, he had served in one of the signals communities. He served in the NSA, or a military version, one of the military branches, and he said, no, don't do that. I said, no, don't worry about it. I said, I'm not going to ever connect it to the internet. He said, you're not listening to me. I said, no, I'm not. Why can't I do it? He said, don't put anything in a computer. So I went back to Diffie-Hellman, you guys all know that, with Diffie and the Hellman public key encryption system, and the other guy that got in trouble years. And it turned out that in the late 80s, a professor named Hellman and a really major league hacker named Whit Diffie, who I still talk to a lot, devised a public key whatever number of bits, I know anything, 128-bit, I guess, encryption system that drove the NSA crazy. They were going to jail him, and they struck a deal. And the best guess, when I did work on this, the best guess I got was the deal was that all American companies that sell computers overseas, the NSA was happy with this. This was in the early Clinton years, would put some string, some X's and O's in, on anything sold overseas. So the assumption I make 10 years later when somebody says, don't put anything in a computer, is the obvious assumption that it's still there. There's still X's and O's in everything we have. That doesn't mean they can get access to it, but there's obviously some way. I think it takes some physical entry, but there's obviously some way. I mean, they're pretty good. They're pretty good at what they do. So what? I mean, 40 years ago they could wire your house, so what? It's always adversarial. And so I know it's more sophisticated, so what? So what? You still do what you do. Let me say this to you real simple. When you have something like the stolen documents and you decide you're only going to publish part of it, here's the story, here's the thing. We're not breaking the law. We're not the guys that are violating the rights here, around the world, particularly in America, constitutional rights. We're not listening to everything. We're not cheating. We're not violating the Fourth Amendment, and also I will tell you the Fifth Amendment, the right to self-defense, because if you don't think some of this stuff is used in court cases, you don't know anything. Of course it is. If you're in the Justice Department, you've got a tough case, and you can't crack somebody you can get from the NSA the last 2 years of his emails, come on. It's going to be hard not to do it. In fact, I know it happened. It's a tough one. Anyway, the bottom line is, so why be afraid? Why not write everything? Do it. Why let the Guardian guy did, why let some thugs come into your office and destroy documents that you know exist elsewhere and not tell anybody about it? Why not stand up there? Why let set a precedent? Why not publish what everything Snowden says? Not if you're going to jeopardize a lot of lives. No, of course, obviously common sense comes into that. But in terms of collecting information, we shouldn't hesitate. The guys that should worry are the guys that are violating the laws.
Well, that's what I wanted to ask you about. What are the consequences for your sources, and have they changed? How have they changed over the decades?
Oh, I'm not going to talk about any of that stuff.
Go on, a little bit.
No.
What do they face?
No, absolutely not. I don't ever do that. I wouldn't begin to do that stuff.
But the risk they run. Why do they
run? No, it's none of nobody's business. I don't want to do anything that does. I wouldn't do it. Just won't do it.
I think I'm asking because of the discussion.
I know what you're asking. I'm just telling you very politely. Go away.
See how he does it. But the question of secrecy is not... The discussion that we're having around surveillance is also a discussion around secrecy. And the requiring of secrecy, the gag orders, the national security letters, the risk that people face in telling their stories is another aspect of this story that I think it deserves to.
You're absolutely right.
All right, enough said. They run high risks, let's just say.
Some may not. Let's leave it that way. I'll never write a memoir, damn it. But you'd be amazed. It was mentioned earlier. I don't know whether by Mr. Logan or by Gavin, that there are people who are not whistleblowers in the sense that they don't go public. But what you find are there are people. Look at it this way: you're committed. You're a young officer. You're a young general. You're a one-star general. You get assigned to Washington. Let's say in 2000, and you're assigned to the vice president's office, Al Gore. Election comes in, you've got a three-year assignment, and here comes Dick Cheney, and you're suddenly in the midst of madness. What do? You think you can be chairman of the Joint Chiefs and make a four-star, just as they do here. You think you can make the top rank, and you don't want to throw away your year. You don't want to leak. You don't want to be caught, but you can't stand what you're seeing. So that's where there's a nexus. You know, that kind of nexus is there. For somebody, what I'm saying is there are people of integrity, a lot quit. If you're really smart, you should all watch retirement lists, not only in the military, but in corporations. Take a look at a corporation, and just what I always did when I want to look at a corporation, I get, it's all public record, get a corporate directory, and I generally go to the Treasury office because it's always about money. It's somebody who can't stand what he sees happening. And so you see some very senior guy in the Treasury office, 1 year he's not there, and then you've got something. That's all. But that's simple. I mean, it's actually very effective. But that's one way to do it. But that all these questions and this stuff is we should really be talking about the end of the world because we're getting there.
I was going to ask you a question about the golden age of do-it-yourself journalism. Can we just remind people that when you broke the Mealy story, you were breaking it for Dispatch. We forget. How does that period compare to this one in terms of your resources as a journalist?
I've done enough of that. Let's come on.
Well, can we just remember those of us who
you don't
are
have
in
to be,
the independent
You don't have
media?
To be in the New York Times or something like that. The idea that the New York Times is narrative. You want to be counter-narrative. I worked at the New York Times, and what I can tell you is I remember even Noam once in a while would call up and be amazed at some horrible thing that happened in the paper, and I would talk about Chomsky. And I would say, hey, you know, listen, you got it wrong. If there's going to be a social revolution or social change in America, the New York Times won't know about it for 6 months. They're not there. They're very good. They have very good reporters. They're not there. The New York Times, the last time I looked at them, was they were reporting almost daily sort of anti-nuclear treaty with Iran. You know, every day writing another story from the center-right guy that runs the International Atomic Energy Agency, the Japanese guy who's in our pocket. You know, they're raising questions about stuff that had been asked by El Baradi when he ran that agency years ago. It all had been answered. And so, you know, the New York Times goes, they have their point of view, and they have their sources, and they're mostly, I'm sort of embarrassed for the paper these days, having worked there. It's just too bad. And that doesn't mean it's not the best there is.
The New York Times lost, Washington Post lost this NLRB's game. The London Review's game. You're publishing more.
Yeah. Okay.
Talk a bit about politics, indeed. I mean, Nixon was booted out of office for wiretapping, what, one hotel suite? And now we have sort of every American citizen being snooped on, and there hasn't even been one
prosecution.
What happened?
Here's where I differ. I think the mass collection, and it's not just collection here, it's worldwide.
Yeah.
The collection's been worldwide, and it's been going. I can tell you, I'm sure Jim Bamford knows more about it than most, and he does know more about it than most. It's been going on where Quantico, they've been downlinking stuff for generations. And the idea of having the capability to listen to everybody. I'm a kid reporter for, was the AP, no, in the 70s, I guess at the New York Times, and I got into some stuff that involved a general who was being watched because a very senior general this is so dated, he was having an affair with a foreign officer, and there was a lot of worry about him. And I got him with the, that wasn't what I was doing, but I got him with the guys who in the Army's version, it was then called the INSCOM, I guess, or I don't know, that's today, whatever. They changed the names of these NSA components. It used to be called the Air Force, AFSS, Jim, what's it now? What's it called, the Air Force version now of the NSA?
They've changed it about 10 times.
The Navy Security Group is still the same, isn't it, NSG?
No, it's
they change all these names. They think that's good security, I guess. I don't know what it is. Maybe they just buy more paper. You know, they have a contract. Somebody knows somebody who's in the stationary business. I don't know what it is. I mean, believe me. And so anyway, the point of all this is, I forgot what the point of it was. I give speeches often, if they're not here because it's smaller, but there's a large crowd. I asked somebody in the front row to remember where I was. I don't remember.
I asked about Nixon versus today. Why absolutely zero prosecutions?
I know what I was going to say. I don't know. How the hell do I know? I don't know why the government does or doesn't do anything. It's more about ignorance and stupidity than anything else, and cowardice than any plot. I mean, the amount of ignorance that exists in the government is pretty astonishing. I mean, we're still doing a Cold War. Just think what would happen if we in the West had just let the Russians hang around Afghanistan and hadn't bothered to start up with the Sunni fundamentals in the 80s. You know, this cool thing we did in the end of the Carter administration. We thought we'd beat the Russians back by dealing with Bin Laden and the boys. Just think what would happen if we just kept our nose out of it, as Russia kept its nose out of our war in Vietnam. They supported the North, not the North. Anyway, we just did dumb stuff.
It was really a question largely about us. Outrage then.
The point of the metadata is that in America, I think the GCHQ does it differently. They don't deal with the mass metadata. They do more careful cases. They're relying on artificial intelligence. And as long as that, you know, what's the IQ of artificial intelligence? You can't really make a judgment about it. What I was going to tell the story was, in the 70s, I was dealing with guys in the Army and signals, and they were in the NSA equivalent. They were looking at some general, and I got buddy-buddy with a couple of them, and one of them had a lot of troubles. And so, of course, he just wired the hell out of the house. Photographs, pictures, intercepts, all that stuff. They were telling me about it in the 70s. And so let me say to you this. If you have the capability, and certainly we've had a capability, Fred Church didn't really, the Church Committee really didn't stop at the local investigation we had in America in the 70s. If you have the access, you're going to take it. That doesn't have to be high level. It could be even one going into looking at one particular computer, or going into wiring up a house, you're going to take it if you're going to listen if you can. So the notion that this is new, and I think actually, in a way, the metadata is. Somebody said it was a chilly thing that was said. We're hiring 20,000 more people, and it might get better, but it might not. I mean, it's really pretty bad. The single most overrated agency in the United States is the NSA. If it wasn't for all these, wasn't for the Enigma and all this love stuff that came out, the Turi movie is coming right now, the Hodges book is coming back, which is a great book, Andrew Hodges' book. If it wasn't for the myth, and it's not a myth, it's that what happened here and with the Japanese code in World War II, that sustained the NSA. It is so fucked up. They can't get anything right. They're the most over. I hope Jim talks about it. I shouldn't put words in his mouth, but we did talk about it earlier. It's just the most useless, unproductive agency. It doesn't get much. Any given day, they can, if they decide to go after you, they can do a hell of a job, but they always could. They could go back and get every your email, all your phone conversations now, because it's all on tap, but it's been on tap for a long time. They can have access to it. And the fact that there's so much, the world's there. You know, being stockpiled now in a new facility we're building, it's there, is threatening. But it's also a question of how do they retrieve it. And I don't think 200,000. I'm not worried about them as much as I'm just not as worried about them. I just don't want to worry about them. I know you guys should be, and you are. I'll let you worry about it. I have other things to worry about.
It was interesting when they were trying to track the trajectory of a nurse who had been exposed to Ebola. Do you remember this?
Sure.
She traveled to Texas somewhere, Dallas or something.
They couldn't.
And then they asked, that she'd gone through Washington, And they asked anybody who had been on that flight to please get in touch with them.
Right. Well, how about Snowden? They got the wrong plane. They forced down the wrong plane. I mean, are you kidding? What does that tell you? I'm serious. I'm really serious. You know, they this day and age, and Snowden, you know, I've said this to his attorney, do not come back to America. You're going to have to stay somewhere. I'm sorry. Do not come back to America. There is a great deal of, and I will also tell you something from the inside, and I'm sure Jim, if he doesn't know it, I'd be amazed. Their internal assessments, and this I do know, are very little damage, none damage. All the stuff came out. That doesn't mean embarrassment, yes, but the fact that, you know, has it changed our ability to do stuff against ISIS or this fake organization called Al-Qaeda that really pretty much disappeared a long time ago. We have groups that espouse that policy. Well, Al-Qaeda is just a word because it's just a word. It's just a scare word. We live with a lot of scares. I mean, there's a lot of bad groups out there, and they're remnants of Al-Qaeda, but that's not the real game. It's Sunni fundamentalism. And let's do a few more because
we're
running
so late. Well, let's talk about
scares.
You told us things not to be scared of. I'm struck by the things that we're actually celebrating. Covert operations. In the era of Laos, Cambodia, people didn't make movies about their assassination raids.
Oh, I'm going to write a lot. I'm writing, doing something now about Zero Dark 30. That's agoprop. Yes.
So what is a covert operation today? Seems like substance of movie making.
Okay. I can't do that.
Give us a glimpse of your book that you're talking about for Zero.
That's just an article. No, I've been doing a book on Cheney for a long time. And
Didn't you call it his assassination squad?
Yeah, I did do that. I said that once. I was giving, stupidly, just to show you how things work, how dumb I can be, I was giving a speech with Walter Mondale, a former senator whose life changed. He was a very conservative senator, really a Democrat from Minnesota. But he got on the church committee, the investigation in the 70s that was done, one of the first official investigations done by Congress. And they were bright people. Right? Congress now is full of yahoos. But then they were really bright people. And he got frightened by what he learned. So I was invited, he invited me to come do a lecture with him, some fancy lecture at the University of Minnesota, for which they had prepaid. It was a series, and there were 2,000 tickets sold. And the day I got there in the morning and began to snow, by 8 o'clock at night when it was supposed to, we were supposed to have the talk, there was 3 feet of snow. So, you know, we did the talk, but only a couple hundred people showed up. And so we just sat and chatted. And I forgot about these things with cameras, you know, these handheld little iPhones. And so I went on about assassination teams in the CIA. And yes, there are such things. Yes, we kill people. Yes, if you think it stopped. I got a bridge I want to sell you. Nothing stopped. And if you think the Brits are not deeply involved in some dirty shit, let me tell you they are. There's things that are just awful that still go on. People still get tortured, still get, you know, in the old days it was fingernails, but it's a lot worse than that now.
So go back to the end of the world.
As I believe it is?
Yeah. What can we do? I mean it seriously, what actually can we do?
Well, the West can get the hell out of it. That's the first thing. We should get out. The best thing that could happen is we get out. We stop playing. We should treat what's happening between Russia, between Putin and the Ukraine as a family fight and let it go at that. You know, West Ukraine had, what, two divisions fought with the Nazis at Stalingrad. And, you know, don't forget, the West's history of any time there was any group that was going to fight communism, no matter how awful they were, no matter what kind of fascists they were around the world, we would support them. So one can only begin to imagine how much support West Ukraine got before everything started. It's just something. You know how you don't look at things? I'll give you a counter-narrative. We hated the Iranians. They kicked out the Shah, our great guy. They overthrew the government, and we were embarrassed, and they had our diplomats hostage. So in 1980, we pushed hard with Saddam Hussein, this no-good son of a bitch, secular. Ba'ath Party is very secular. And we pushed him to get in, to provoke a war with Iran, and it goes on for 6 years. By 1986, it's huge. By the middle 1980s, it's a horrific war. Hundreds of thousands killed. They would hang them up on the poles. You've read some of these stories. If you go to the Iranians, will tell you this stuff. There was just mass, like primitive warfare. And we gave them all the stuff. We gave Saddam chemical weapons that they're digging up now, some of them. We gave him biological assets. We gave him some stuff that they could see if they could work out some sort of chemical or biological weapons. We gave him money, guns, and we were his great allies. We pushed him, pushed him, pushed him. He was not winning the war, but we were his guys. And so one day in late 1986, he picks up the newspaper, and what does he read? There's something called the Iran-Contra scandal. The guys that are helping him are selling TOW missiles, which are much more effective than anything the Iranians had to use against him, selling TOW missiles via the Israelis. The Israelis, my God. So they can generate profits. The Iranians would pay much more than the missiles they were worth, and the profits would be used by the Bush, by the Reagan White House to finance the war against the Sardinistas. So he picks up a paper. These sons of bitches that have been supporting him for years are all of a sudden giving his enemy weapons. So you tell me what he thinks about us. You tell me how much respect he has for us. You tell me there were a lot of stories of whether or not a diplomat named Abel Glaspie gave him the go-ahead in 1991 to go in and start that, you know, move in on Saudi Arabia and Kuwait, if you remember, or Kuwait actually, whether he was going to go to Saudi Arabia or not, I don't know. But there have been long-standing disputes about oil and about energy. There was a lot of digging, on sideways digging, and there was disputes about whose oil was what. And he finally moved against the Kuwaitis, and there was a lot of debate in America. Well, he must have been given a heads up. Are you kidding me? He couldn't care less what we thought. We had just double-crossed him in the open, and nobody ever looks at it that way. Not that I have any sympathy for Saddam. It's just another counter-narrative. And so that's what you think about. That's what the business is about. It's about trying to think from other people's point of view what's going on. And it gets very interesting. And you get, you know, and so the problem is, I'm perennially disappointed because when I worked at the New York Times, I could write stories that were contrary. And they were welcome, but everything wears out. And so you don't see enough of the contrary reporting now in the mainstream press. And that's why what I thought 15, 20 years ago, the idea was underground press. Remember, 30 years ago, there was every newspaper, every city had an underground newspaper that was very energetic and alive. They didn't make it. And so now we have BuzzFeed, I don't know the name, they are all these groups
online.
I don't know what's going to happen, but it's certainly interesting. They're going to get better. I think this guy Omidyar just threw away $50 million. That's too bad. I wish I had it. I could do a lot better with it than he's doing. That's it.
I mean, it sounds as if a lot of what you're saying to this conference that is about alliance building against secrecy, surveillance, and censorship is that perhaps what we need to be against is more totalitarianism, fascism, and the end of the world. How are the two related?
Well, it's just a double standard here we have that we've had since, look, it's all about oil. I mean, why do you think we kiss the ass of the Saudis? Does anybody doubt that the Saudis, if we really knew everything, would probably have been much more deeply entrenched in some of the jihadist activities, even with bin Laden? We don't know who finances who. There's 10,000 members of the family, they owe a lot of money. And so we repression in Saudi Arabia, you don't hear much about it. Repression in Bahrain, you don't hear much about it. You know what's going on in the Gulf states now? They're in a panic. Because clearly, the best army now in the Middle East is the Syrian army, whether you like them or don't like them. It's been battle-tested. Hezbollah came and taught them, stop using the American tactics of firing missiles first and going in. Go on the boots on the ground, hit the Hezbollah. I happen to think Nasrallah is probably the most interesting guy. I've seen him 5 or 6 times, which is a lot. I don't write everything about it because I want to keep on seeing him. But he is really a very interesting guy and very smart and is much cooler than we think. And the people in America are beginning to realize that he stayed a very low profile, despite the fact he has a capability. The Israelis certainly know. So we have sponsored a lot. We look the other way at most of the Sunni demagogues, Qatar. I mean, come on. UAE has been arresting people. They deported many Shia with any clout. A year ago, they threw them out in 24 hours. They're arresting people. In Jordan, when we're giving a speech, the king is repressing the press like crazy. He's arresting people. We're having a great repression all over it. There's very little press freedom in the Gulf states. They're in a free fall panic about Iran coming, panic about what's going to happen. And we don't even see that story.
But again, what I'm hearing is, you're the keynote for this conference.
Keep our eyes
on a different kind of prize. While we care about surveillance, censorship, and secrecy, what I'm hearing from you is the journalistic agenda. Keep a focus on the journalistic storytelling.
Look, I can't even program my computer to watch a TV show I want to watch, so I'm a total dweeb when it comes to that stuff. There are people here, and you're going to learn a lot more. I respect people that do. I'm sort of a Bruce Schneier fan, you know? And what does he say if he's got a new book coming out? I read him because he's smart. I mean, some of you, that doesn't mean others aren't smart. What does he say? What he says is what the whole problem with the encryption issue, this is in the new book, I don't know when he's going to publish it. I've seen it in draft. One of the issues he raises that's really profound is you guys who know an awful lot about computers, you have to do more for the dummies. You're not doing enough for the dummies. There are a lot of people like me who would probably be much more open to some kind of encryption if I didn't think it was so complicated. I know you all think it's easy, but it's not for a lot of people. So for people that are, you know, over 20, over 30, over 40, when I have trouble with my computer, I wait for some 10-year-old kid to walk by. Bring him in, and he can do it. He can program. They all can do it. You know, they're amazing. So I think there has to be some way to really get it going. You're never going to get encryption in the major corporations because no president wants to give up that power. He doesn't want some security guy telling him that the secretary is banging, or the boyfriend he's banging. I don't want to get into it. Is going to lose her because they did something stupid. They have to be fired. And security people, that's what you're going to do. If you let the security people in, they're going to start saying you can't tolerate people who slip up, you know, on an encryption or a key. You really have to be tough. And nobody wants to give up that power. And anyway, the cost is 6 or 7% by Visa. So you know they lose that percent. It might cost more to encrypt. So how are you going to convince them to encrypt? So you're still going to have all these scandals go on and nobody really does a hell of a lot with it. So I think there has to be some thinking about that, but I don't know anything about that. I just know that I'm sitting with maybe 25,000 single spaces of pages and no computer except my brain and I'm going nuts because I won't put it in a computer. And I like it that way. I don't put anything in a computer. I don't put any, you pick up my iPhone, there won't be one name. I've got my wife and my kids and other stuff in there. There won't be one phone number of anybody who comes close to being a source. So that's how I protect people, by keeping them off the internet. And that's possible. It's just burdensome, cumbersome. But it doesn't mean I don't email people, because some of the people I deal with know how to do it. Mm-hmm. People know how to do it, but I don't. Anyway, big deal. That's not what I know. What I know is that what you're doing is very useful, because what Snowden did didn't work in the sense in the long run. Congress, we've got troglodytes in the Congress, and racists, and so I was joking that. I won't say what I want to say.
Don't say that.
But I mean, anyway, I just think that, you know, it's sort of sad now. It's coming down to, you know, it's coming down to some form of racism in America again.
I think it's coming up from some kind of
racism. Yeah, I don't know. I thought when he won re-election. But he's been a crashing disappointment to Obama. So anyway, that's another story. But by doing what you're doing, you're keeping those guys at bay. You're scaring them. They are scared. They're scared to death. Snowden shook up the community big time, because you know how many Snowdens are there. They don't know, and they worry about it because they're very sloppy in how they pass out stuff, very very sloppy, and they, as you said, they can't find out. They don't even know what they've done wrong. They can't find it. The level of incompetence that goes on. Here's my take on the NSA. We ought to get out of here because we're only running about an hour late already. My take on the NSA is the guys that actually know stuff are as like in the after the Civil War, if you remember, we had serfs. The blacks became field hands. They were the field hands, and they were the people. And there was there were a middle management group that would come and give them the seeds in the beginning of the year, at the end of the year, would take. pay a few cents for the crops, and then that's how they survived. This horrible stuff that went on after the Civil War, it wasn't much better in the South. Then you have middle management who do the bidding, and then on top you have the guys that run the NSA, the generals and the admirals who are both the guys in NSA, and I'm sure Jim knows this, the phrase they used for them for years was the summer help, because the general and admirals never knew jack shit about what was going on. They never could understand anything. They were just their politician, politically. And they sit there like the lord of the manors drinking mint juleps. And the guys who actually run stuff never connect with the guys on top because they can't talk to each other. So it's a completely dysfunctional place. Completely. It really is. It still is. It's a place of enormous dysfunction. And we can't get to it because of secrecy. I think that may be cracking. You guys may open up the door on that a little bit. And that would be good. It's an agency that has to be really cleaned out. It's a menace to itself because it's incompetent. But the information they had, if somebody really competent got in there, as somebody said, just remember the Boston case. The Russians warned us. The evil, awful Russians. Don't forget the evil, awful Russians that you can't trust for anything. They warned us about two guys in Boston that were saying crazy things that were really nuts. And they told the government. They warned us about it. And specific warnings. And we knew nothing until afterwards. Then afterwards, we were able to find out that his wife on the phone a month earlier had said some terrible things. And they were stupid enough to say, oh, we know the wife was talking earlier. And we were like, this is way before Snowden. How did they know? I remember that. I said to myself, my God, I can't believe I'm down there. I mean, nobody asked that question. How did they know what she was saying 2 months earlier? Because not because they targeted them, because they clearly didn't, but they had everything. So you could argue that the stuff they had could be useful for police work, except who can trust the police? So don't worry. It's okay. That's my message. Keep on doing what you're doing. I'll do what I'm not going to jail. My guys aren't going to jail. That's the way it is. There's a lot of other reporters doing work just like me. I'm not alone. There are a lot of really good stuff going on.
Journalism still a good field to go into?
Oh my God. Would I rather be a journalist or are you kidding? Are you kidding? Okay, I've had great luck. I found some great stories and I did them. But in principle, the principle that we are here to keep them in check, to keep the powers that be in check, that's the only thing between them and chaos and fascism, if you will. We can keep them in check because they lie. They lie. They are friggin' liars because it's so easy to lie, to tell the truth. We had a president of the United States that had the most single important thing going was Obamacare, was health care. And the day the computers were to run was the day he learned that nothing was going to work and that everybody in his staff had known for weeks and months that it was, and nobody told them. What does that tell you about the system? It's completely dysfunctional. It's dysfunctional. And these are the people that are going to be dealing with world events. We have a role to play. We can at least keep them afraid of us. I know it sounds Pollyannish, I don't think my stories about Mili changed the war. What I think what happened is they were forced to prosecute Lieutenant Calley, and he was found guilty by a group of, in the army, you're tried by your peers. A group of army peers said he murdered a lot of people, and after that, Richard Nixon could not rally what they called Middle America. The war was over. But it wasn't.
You played a part.
I played a part, but I didn't do it. So, but that's the point. The point is you can get it going, and those things are important. And these conferences are great because they do, you're not alone. And you're not alone with your anxieties and your fears. They're really real. And so by you guys in the computer world, by keeping this counter pressure going on, you really do a lot more than you think you do. And that's why I say Snowden should stay put. They don't need him. We don't need him in jail. Just think of a change, by the way. Last thing. Dan Ellsberg, who truly did something remarkable, and truly did something. He released a series of internal papers that showed that the government had been lying systematically to us about the Vietnam War since the early days of the Kennedy administration.
Pentagon
papers in 1971. He did that. And when he admitted he did it, he was arraigned. He was brought before a judge. The judge held him. There was going to be a grand jury investigation. He was going to be charged. He was released on bail. And for the next 18 months, he continued making anti-war speeches. When he finally had a trial, it was determined that wiretapping had been involved and corrupt communication between the judge and the White House. The judge named Byrne had been talking to people in the White House, and the case was thrown out. But for 18 months, this man had released these most secret documents, was allowed to walk around free. And think about what happens to people like the poor fellow that's in jail now that worked with Assange. Think about what happened now. There's been a huge sea change in America. And it's gone way crazy on this stuff. So, you know, that's why, you know, all the questions you want to ask are just, you know, you can't get into it.
You went exactly where we wanted you to go, so I thank you.
Goodbye,
I think
guys.
I hear the final words from you were, don't be afraid, but keep them afraid.
Well, you are. They're scared. They really are scared. So don't freak them out.
Seymour Hersh, thanks so much. Goodbye.
No coffee break, we're running late.